Hello, everybody, and welcome to another session of Team Cymru's Dragon Den. I'm your host today, Dave Monnier, Team Cymru Fellow. And today we're joined by special guest, Peter Anaman of the Microsoft's Corporate External and Legal Affairs Digital Crimes Unit, where he serves as Director and Principal Investigator. Prior to that, Peter was a senior internet investigator at the London office of Cummington & Burling, a law firm headquartered in the United States in Washington, D.C. And then prior to that, he did forensic accounting data analysis team lead at PricewaterhouseCoopers. Peter has also served as an artillery platoon officer in the French Army. Peter, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you for your kind invitation and look forward to our conversation in the den.
Excellent. So, folks, if you haven't joined us before, what a Dragon's Den is where we sit down and kind of have just a honest and organic conversation with our guests. We have prepared in advance some set of seed questions that we'll work through to help guide our discussion today. But we will very likely sway from there. We have some opportunity to ask Q&A. So if at any time while we're chatting, if something comes up that you'd like to see more about or hear more about, go ahead and open the Q&A option. There's a button at the bottom of your screen that you can open and type your questions there. From there, we'll moderate those questions and do our best to answer them. Additionally, desire to ask or discuss anything or add something that isn't a question, perhaps add something to the conversation, you're free to add things in the chat window. There's also a chat window. Without further ado, we'll go ahead and get started. So Peter, tell us about what you do at the DCU. Tell us what the DCU does for Microsoft in terms that kind of everyone could follow. If you had to explain it to someone who was, say, not technical, how would you describe what you guys do?
So the Digital Crimes Unit, or DCU, is an organization which actually falls under the Customer Security and Trust org within the company. And our core focus is mission is to fight global cybercrime with innovative technologies and legal strategies. And to accomplish this, what we do is that we have teams in different regions. So the headquarters is in Redmond, in the Pacific Northwest, North America. Then we have a team in Latin America, LATAM. We have a team in EMEA, so Europe, Middle East, and Africa, covering that region. And we have a team in APAC and China. So within those teams, we're broken down into different expertise, if I can use that word. We have attorneys that have different specialisms, but focus mainly on prosecution, but other areas of law. We have investigators who identify and investigate cases that we can discuss more a bit later on. And we have analysts and engineers who help us with data. We know to conduct the investigation, we typically have to look at petabytes of data that are being ingested in order to find indicators of compromise and help build support cases. So that is DCU as an organization. And I think it'd be worth noting that we don't work in a silo. We work and collaborate across our company with different organizations, both from a product security stance, but also groups that are looking to protect our customers and earn the trust that they can work on our platform. So, in a nutshell, I think that's what DCU can be considered to be.
Yeah, fantastic. So obviously that makes it sound like you're doing quite interesting and amazing things. There's no shortage of bad guys in the world. Let me ask you, is there an incident that you're most proud of?
I think there could be several types of cases, which I think I've been proud of participating in, or that I am part of a group that is handling it. One example is, for example, how in this world we operate in, cybercrime is global, and which means that the criminals have no mercy on who they're attacking. And working within the DCU, we often we at times receive referrals from industry partners or from law enforcement about cases they investigated. And being able to help someone and protect them, it's just second to none for me, because I wake up in the morning and I feel proud that I've been able to use the skills and expertise I've learned over 20 years and more in order to go out there and help people. The second is that when we speak about incident, it's also about looking across the border. So within Microsoft, there is something called a hackathon. And each year, the company brings together, organizes a three-day event when anyone can create any project, and then and after 3 days, we kind of see what you've done. So I've participated in one based on my expertise dealing with cybercrime in finding, for example, missing children. So we work with a charity, and in there, we looked at how do we use AI, so cognitive services, to look at images of missing children. And then what we found is that by aging them by 1 year, we were almost able to find a way to follow them over a decade, because when they go missing, the picture is too old. And so this is part of how within our company, they encourage us to really go beyond just your day job, but try to say, how can you help other things? And that is also something I'm proud of, because again, we're looking to protect people and earn their trust. So those would be like two examples of things I can think about.
Yeah, fantastic. I believe I actually saw a small mini documentary about that hackathon effort. It used some Azure AI technologies that were very unique to Microsoft's platform. I believe I saw like an infomercial on a on an airplane once I was flying on. I thought, wow, I know a bunch of those guys. So right. So hats off. And protecting kids absolutely is near and dear to us as well. So hats off to that. So
thank you.
Obviously, there's successes in the world, but and I won't necessarily ask you, you know, what's a failure, but let me ask you, is there a case where you wish you would have done it maybe differently, that you could have gotten a different or a better outcome?
I think there are actually several cases, and I explained why I say several, because they are kind of interlinked. Each day I wake up, I have to acknowledge that we live in a very, very diverse world. And when I'm communicating on the internet with cyber criminals, they may be in different parts of the country. So for example, if I came to you from the US and I said LAFNAC, F-N-A-C, you probably wouldn't know what that is. If I went to someone in France and said Best Buy, they wouldn't know what that is, because these are like culturally, the localized cultures and things which define our identities in multiple levels. So when I look at a cyber criminal, I often have to sort of take a back seat and say, these are different people. They could be in different places. And how can I be humble about my knowledge, about the way I look at the world? Because the way I build a case and create the evidence is always going to be different. As an example, I was in Egypt training some generals there on some cybercrime training. And during one of the breaks, they said, oh, are you going to be one of those people who fly in and fly out and don't really help us? And I said, well, thank you for that feedback, because I would never have thought that. And they actually strengthened the case, and we developed good relationships to move forward. In another case in Iceland, we knew that what I didn't know, and the case could have been blown, was that the criminal there was very sophisticated and had multiple layers of encryption on his device. And so there needed to be a distraction within a few seconds whereby we could intervene. So the evidence I was collecting outside in IRC and other channels had to be coordinated. I think where I'm going with this, Dave, is that when I look back, I see many things I could have changed because I just didn't know. And as we as a collective, we need to be open-minded that we're now facing criminals for many, many more areas. And what I mean by that is today, I think internet connection is about 3-4 billion. Well, we are 7 billion people. What about when the others jump on? How are we going to be prepared? Because the AI and all these tools we're building has to be flexible enough in order to address those things. Otherwise, we risk having problems, right, that could have been prevented. So I think that's something I learned, and how I'm constantly challenging myself to move forward and communicating about it.
Yeah, that's very, very interesting. In particular, your perspective of trying to humble yourself so as to not get caught up in your own biases. It's interesting. I often try to describe to people when they're doing incident response, IR forensic investigation. I try to tell people, don't Don't go into it expecting to go find what it is that happened. Try to just replay the time and let what happened present yourself. Because lots of times I've seen people do things where they thought they understood what they should be looking for, but they only know to look for things they know of. And if what's happened is new to them, they won't see it. So that's a great reminder. I'd love to hear your methods on how you could coach yourself under duress like that sometime, but we can do that over a pint sometime. Curious though, so adversaries out in the world, by the time they come up to being an issue to the DCU, they must be big fish. Because I can't imagine that you guys are troubling yourselves with kind of the small guys. They must be, a pretty serious person. And given that, they're probably typically fairly capable and have methods and tools that maybe we've not seen before. So I'm curious, what's something that you've learned from a subject while investigating them? Like, have you ever been taught some magic, if you will, whether it be technical or not, isn't necessarily the case, but what have you learned from one of the people you've been investigating?
This may sound a bit strange, but what I've learned is it's tough because I find that at times we sometimes use the hat, we act with a hammer and everything's a nail kind of concept. And when we look at targets, what I've learned from them is that there is a reason why they are doing what they're doing. As an example, recently I've started to explore with the amazing encouragement from from DCU and the leadership in Microsoft to start looking at crime from a different lens. Is that why do people commit crimes? Why are they centers of concentration of crimes? And if it's about jobs, then what can we do about that? Because what I found is, what I've learned is, a lot of these people at times just wanted a job, but they couldn't get a job. And so they started to do little things here and there, which became bigger things as they learned more about the internet and how to get access to different resources. Like an investigation about 2 months ago, I think it is now, we could see that that the person was actually learning how to use Azure. So he was using Azure, but he was just learning it. And so what I've learned is that we need to also look at crime, online criminality, from a different perspective. And how do we sort of listen more and try and maybe act to prevent the criminal becoming a criminal? Of course, the most important thing is that we have to earn the trust of our customers. And so whether you are a one-man band or a larger organized crime network, it's the same. Where we want to protect our customers. So we don't really distinguish. We prioritize, of course, but we look at how to protect our customers.
Great. So yeah. What's something you've had to do as part of that process, as part of that job, that people wouldn't expect to be part of a cyber criminal investigation?
Well, can't discuss too much on TTPs, but in one case, so I've got several ledgers like most of us do, and I had to spend a month literally following the time zone of a person in Eastern Europe in order to earn their trust and have a complete almost relationship, because they were using quite advanced encryption and we couldn't get the keys. And so there had to be a way to earn the trust in order to be able to get a copy of that. And so the ledger was, was well coordinated. And I think sometimes when you're a cybercrime investigator, people imagine that it's so glamorous, but sometimes it's really not. I was literally in spreadsheets and databases trying to figure out the data to know how to communicate. You know, I had to program in various query, SQL queries. I had to learn LAMP, so Linux, Apache, MySQL, and PHP, because that's some of the technologies they were using. I had to pivot and start doing other things. And that comes with the job. No one sees that part. And it reminds me when I was doing a master's in information security, at the Royal Holloway in the UK, a lecturer told me, give it a few months, all these people are going to drop out. I was like, what do you mean? They're like, well, they're all watching CSI. And so they see all the movies and think that that's what cyber investigation, cybersecurity about. And it's not, right? It's you have to have grit to get through. You have to accept that there are times you're literally in a database writing queries, and that's what it is. And so I think it's that mundane part that I think it's important to know, because if some of the listeners want to come in this field, you have to be prepared and have the passion to get through it, right? And I think, you know, Dave, we spoke about this some time ago, grit is so important because it's not all glamorous.
Yeah, it certainly isn't. And I think it's probably not uncommon at all for people to think that, hey, I've gone to college, I got my degree, I've learned what I learned, now I get to go to work. Whereas if I'm understanding, you're saying that sometimes the learning is never over. You have to learn all new things and whatnot, because otherwise, the effectiveness of you doing an investigation just won't be there. So right. I think that's a good lesson for people to realize, is the thing that they have to do is continuously learn for sure.
And I think maybe I'll add a little bit more to the learning part. Mm-hmm. One thing I realized, you know, when I started out was there was just so much to do, and there was only 24 hours in the day. And so what I started to practice is that, is there a way that anything I do repeated like 3-4 times, can I automate it? And that starts to move into this new world where we need to work in partnership with AI. We need to work with partnership with technology and automation, because that's the best version of us. It means that we can focus our energy in other areas whilst the technology supports us. So right now, a lot of the tools I build, they tap into like big data warehouses, crunch data and send it back to me. And now I'm better informed, but I have to learn the languages. So now the last language was Cousteau, and writing Cousteau queries, Cousteau language queries. And again, it was a bit hard, but do you know what? Love it now, because it's so fast. I can get enriched data really quickly. I feel super empowered. And so I think it's something about the learning each time. So how can we push ourselves and ask other people, how are you doing it? Because maybe I can learn from you and also share with other people. Like I spent 2 hours yesterday helping one of our investigators understand the tools I use, right? So that she's better. And then she makes me better, because then she can tell me what she's using. And I think it's this kind of partnership that we should try and develop and in order to learn and grow.
Yeah, absolutely. I would absolutely agree with you with that, working together with folks. For me, it was a component that I got from my military experience. Do you use other parts of your military kind of environment and lessons in your work in DCU?
I think absolutely. It's been very important for many reasons. And also, I would like to say that when I was younger, I also had the opportunity of being trained by the British Army as part of an activity at the school I attended. And so with all of that, I learned about the discipline, right? About it's freezing cold, but we're on a mission. Let's get through it. Rather than, I'll wait a little bit and then go out. It's the grit, right? And the camaraderie. Such diversity, you know, was in my platoon of like 30 people. We had people from French-speaking Africa. We had people from different parts of France. You know, it was this kind of beautiful mélange, as they say in French, you know, mixture of people, and we had to work together. There was a goal. So if you were tired, then I had to carry a gun and I'd carry a 10-kilo backpack, and we had to do it together. And if it happened to me, the same. And also I learned about in leadership is that if you're going to like give punishment to someone, a part of it is your fault because they should not have been there. And so I learned that through the leadership opportunities I've had is always to listen to the people I'm working with in order to get feedback and understand that we are a team, right? And so even now in the DCU, we have such an amazing team. We also have other veterans who work in there, but it's not about just being a veteran. Different people have different skills and are diverse in different ways. But what we bring, I think, as a veteran is this kind of rigor that was taught into us, and this kind of diverse view of the world, because our teams were typically diverse, right, from different socioeconomic backgrounds, so different genders, you know, it was quite mixed. So it was a great experience that I apply now. Now, sometimes it's tough because when you speak with people who don't look like you, you also have to give back. So I'm quite direct in the way I work, and I've had to learn how to not interpret, but help other people understand that I'm not just trying to be mean or bossy, or I'm just trying to get something done. And I think we also have to work on how to help people understand how we position ourselves at times.
Yeah, I am guilty of the same offense. I can certainly agree. So we have a number of questions that have come in on the Q&A. So folks, to the guests joining us today, we'll go ahead and address these in the last 15 minutes. Thank you. Please keep sending them in. If we get more, we may just curb our own questions and move to them a little bit sooner. But hang with us here for just about 20 more minutes or so, and we'll get to the questions that have come in. So, Peter, it's a very interesting work that you guys are doing for the DCU, but tell me some about your background. Some of the next questions, kind of how you got to the DCU. So, what you had mentioned coming from West Africa, growing up there, what was technology like there, both in terms of geographically, how was it in the region, but in particular at the time, relative to the rest of the world?
So I grew up in the early to mid 70s in Ghana. And during that time, there was a lot of hardship. There was lots of difficulties with the political side of things, which meant that poverty was quite high. People didn't have access to very much because of all the conflicts that existed. And do you know what? Despite all of that, some of my fondest memories were the toys I had. And of course, I was very fortunate. My mother is French-Italian and ended up being a typist at the embassy. So we were fortunate to be probably in the middle class. But all around us, what we had were kids who were smiling, laughing, and made their own toys out of Coca-Cola cans, trash. It was fantastic because, you know what, that kind of inspired me afterwards. So when I eventually left the Ghana and I went to the UK, I gravitated to technology, and I started learning how to make, at the age of 11, 12, alarm systems out of magnets and the currents going through, trying to just make things. And by 13, 14, I started to build my own computers. I started to understand the components and how to put them together. And that just built up from there. So growing up, although there wasn't much, there were ways to be creative. And I think in today's day and age, part of the struggle is everything's one click. And, you know, I was speaking to a kid who would like some guidance on his career. He's 16. I was like, hey, have you built a computer before? What RAM do you put in? Right. And he didn't know, because he didn't need to know. He just bought a laptop and it worked. And I think when you think of cybercrime, we need to try and find a way to be more playful with technology, so that as we see the crimes taking place, we understand how they're taking place. And it's not just theoretical. So yeah, so growing up, the technology wasn't as much, but it was very fun, I think, and playful.
Sure. So what was the first system that you built?
It was a 286 with I think 1 meg of RAM. And I was very proud of myself. It had the biggest monitor in the world. And it was just great. Yeah, it was great.
Sure. And your first operating system?
First operating system was DOS.
Okay. Very cool. Yeah. Very cool. Yeah. So so being there, and obviously if you were building your own computer, so you must have had quite a bit of interaction with technology to get you to that point, right? When was that aha moment when you realized that you wanted to work in technology as opposed to just with it?
I think it would be when I worked in Switzerland. So I was on the case investigating victims of the Second World War who unfortunately, tragically, were killed in the Holocaust. And some of them had placed their funds, their money, before being captured in numbered accounts in Switzerland, thinking that if they were captured, the Germans couldn't get it because the name wouldn't work. They needed the number in the head, but they died with the number. And so this money stayed there. And I was working for this company PwC, and the forensics was highly technical. There was a lot of technology. And I started to see how technology can create wonders, right? How we can get large volumes of data and start to draw inferences from it. And thereafter, when the project came to an end, I heard that a law firm wanted to set up an internet investigations kind of practice because they started to see in 2000 that the internet was becoming malicious. And so I put up my hand and said, I think I want to build a system. And so I went and I got up at 5 in the morning every day, and I started to learn everything about the protocols, OSI, you know, when I say protocols, I mean, for example, NNTP, IRC, FTP, all those protocols where communications can take place, because I had to understand how to capture the evidence in a secure way and make sure the digital chain of custody would be strong. And also, in the evenings, I would just sit in different forums to understand the language because it was foreign to me. And so I had to understand acronyms, the tools which were being used. And that's when I immersed myself into the technology in order to understand how it can be used for good. So, and here I am now. So, it didn't scare me away. There've been times that it's kind of scary. It's complex.
I bet. So we have grit, we have desire to learn, we have some degree of fearlessness as needed talents. What other talents and skills would you say that you developed growing up that got you here that you think you would say you draw on? Like, is it, do you do mathematics? Do you do other talents that you, and for what it's worth, my thought here with this question is maybe to give some savior to math and science teachers around the world for all those people who think, oh, I'll never use that stuff. But curious, do you find yourself using other disciplines?
Not only using other disciplines, but also keeping abreast. So for example, now, as I think of the future, and I think we'll cover it a bit later, but in case we don't, it's looking at quantum technology, right? Quantum cryptography. And how are we going to manage that, right? As defenders when that time comes. So I've been spending a lot of time learning about, I love cryptography. So the maths there is mind-boggling, but I've done an advanced course in order to understand it, because when I look at the world, a lot of it can be derived from all of these sciences, and STEM is so important, right? When I look at, and I would include physics, understanding physics, because that's all about particles, right? It's about moving in things around. Look at the chemistry, these are all things that can help you when you're a defender. So I'm always trying to learn. I have kind of an alert system on news so that I get it. Any new developments get flagged and I can read about it and I can go and experiment with it. So there's that part. I think probably one of the most important things, Dave, is that is curiosity. I think making time to be curious is important, because that's how we innovate and that's how we are kinder to each other and learn from each other. And those are important traits, because otherwise we're stuck in a world and we're not looking more broadly of opportunities. So I think, yeah, those would be the main things.
Sure. So let me ask you, working at the DCU, obviously you see about a lot of bad things on the internet and technology wise. How has your work there changed the way you see and use technology?
Well, I'll give you like a little anecdote. So I came to the US in 2009, and I joined Microsoft in 2008. And I went to my bank account. I opened a bank account, and the lady there was formerly a Russian nuclear physicist. an amazing lady and a husband as well. And they decided they want to try something different. Anyway, I met her then. A few weeks ago, I went back there and she says, oh, you're still in Microsoft. I said, oh yeah, I love it. And she goes, well, what do you do now? I go, oh, I've got exactly the same manager and I'm doing exactly the same thing, but the world has completely changed. Because when I started, it was all about software piracy. It was mainly about software piracy and Xbox and, you know, IP, digital assets. And now it's different, right? It's about phishing, being 70% of all attacks, right, have some kind of social engineering phishing behind it. We see ransomware exploding now, right? But I think the landscape has changed. And so the way I use technology now is that I try and find a way to work in tandem with it. And I'm thinking of Big Blue. So when Big Blue came in and sort of became the champion in chess, everyone's like, oh, the machines are going to take over. But they did another test and they got, if I remember correctly, they got another supercomputer to actually work with the Grandmaster and then compete against Big Blue. Guess who won? The combination. The combination won each time. And I think that is what is key, is how do we use technology in order to build a better world, right? And when you look at the Microsoft platform, it's just amazing how they're enriching, they're allowing people to digitally transform, whether it's through the AI, whether it's through the business productivity suites, right? Whether it's through like teams like the DCU that is dedicated to protecting the customers, right? It's looking at how technology, there are different facets to it, and we need to work together, you know, to move forward. So I think the way I use it now, before, it was less, it was just a Word document in 2000. Well, I was using LAMP and other things, so an IRC channel. It's not what it is now, right? Like I mentioned, Kusto is a whole new world, right? When you can do statistical functions, you can put graphs that come out as you're querying, you see the world in different ways. So I think, yes, that's what I'll say about that.
Okay. So obviously nobody has a crystal ball, but where do you see us heading as a whole with the use of the internet and technology? And as part of that, where do you see criminals going?
That's a hard one. So I think I'll start where the criminals are heading. I see a lot of data. I see, you know, by virtue of what I do and what I've done in the past, and the people I know, my networks, we get to understand the internet and the world in a different way, and we share experiences. And when we think of where the criminals are heading, obviously I can't say too much because then they'll do it, but I think that we have to think of, right? I've spent a lot of time researching this and but we have to think of a bank robber. The bank robber robs a bank, right? Because that's where the money is. He's not gonna do anything different because that's what he does. And when we look at the criminals, I think we need to spend more time understanding them. And I think when we see where they're going, they're gonna become much more powerful, I think, as group, because they're transnational. It's harder to stop because of these barriers that exist in law enforcement, in enforcement. At times, we have seen the amazing work of Europol and the FBI and other agencies, but it's hard. When you don't have jurisdiction, it makes it that much harder and longer. And criminals work at the speed of light because it's the internet, right? So you can move money very fast, right? You think of what's happening with cryptocurrencies and things. So I think we're going to see a rapid acceleration in attacks against corporations because that's where the money is. And in order to address some of the technologies we put in, the obfuscation is going to be harder to pick up because they're just going to break everything up into smaller packets, which will make it harder to look for trends and patterns. So we're going to have to start developing technologies that can sort of piece the information back together after it's been deconstructed. And I mean, I have some ideas around that, but I just see much more sophistication and focus against enterprises because that's where the money is, right? They can make a lot that way. When you look at ransomware, who would have thought we would be where we are 4 years ago? No, it was chop change a few years ago. Now it's millions of dollars and people are paying because there's insurance. Go figure, right? So that's changed landscape. So So that's on that part. Where we're heading as a whole, I think that we're starting to get better at communicating with each other and working with policyholders, communicating to policyholders how we need to improve information sharing, right? We have these kinds of ad hoc things, but privacy is super important, right? Without privacy, we don't earn the trust of our customers, and which means that we can't move forward. So it's how do we develop improved information sharing, which may be encrypted. I don't know how we do it, but we need to work on that, because there's going to be a greater need for corporations that work across different regions to better collaborate with each other and partner with governments and regulators in order to provide the means of protecting young children, women, and older people, and everyone as a whole, right? We need tools. So I think those discussions are in the pipeline, and we just need to find an opportunity to encourage that, right? And say, this is why we need it, right? It's to protect people and ensure that we can all grow and benefit from the advantages of having technology. Otherwise, you know, you just pull the plug and there's no internet. Right?
So obviously you see a bunch of scary things on the internet. Obviously you've been around technology for a very long time and see all of these changes and seen how miscreancy has affected technology, in particular the internet as a whole. What advice do you give your family when they ask about using the internet? What types of pointers and tips and advice do you give them?
I think the first is that I encourage them to go and visit the Microsoft online safety website, and we can provide more information afterwards, because that has really a good summary of all the types of things to do. Let's take, for example, when we are online, you have to understand what the threats are. And I try not to scare them, because then they won't do anything. But, you know, we have drive-by infections. We know that anyone can be anyone out there. So the first thing is check. You know, when you're walking in the street and someone communicates with you, well, you check who they are. You don't just accept it. So if you receive a phone call, an email, check, right? Just to make sure it's the right person. Even if it means picking up the phone and calling them, do that. Make sure your devices are updated and patched, because there's constantly new vulnerabilities which are being identified, and security has to be updated, right? It's like getting a shot, so that you feel better. So I think, you know, legitimate software updates, and more importantly is when looking at, especially in social media, is to be cautious, right? Because not everything you see is right. So take everything with a pinch of salt, because we just don't know who's doing what, when. And probably the last thing I'll mention is, for all your accounts, use MFA. Sometimes it's a burden, but you know what? You'll get used to it. But MFA, so multi-factor authentication, if you have it in your LinkedIn, your work, especially work emails and personal emails like your outlook.com, use MFA, because it creates that level of security that you can just have less to worry about, right? Because otherwise you could be somewhere you could have used the same password, for example, in another site that goes breached, and now someone can combine that with your password and get access to your account. With MFA, it's less of a risk, right? Because they need to have the app, or they need to have your phone, which makes it harder. So, yeah.
Sure. I saw in the news this week that Google has decided to enable 2FA, presumably out of band off to cellular devices, but I saw they're turning it on by default now. And are going back and encouraging people to make use of that capability for their messaging services. I'm curious, do you happen to know if Microsoft has any plans to do the same, or could you see that happening, for example, for like the O365 folks? Obviously, it's not your side of the house, but could you see that happening in the future?
I think you may have read in the press from our CISO, Chief Information Security Officer, Brett Hussle, that we are really pushing towards something called zero trust. And zero trust means that let's make away with passwords and follow and use hello, so image biometrics, or your fingerprints on your phone, for example, or some authentication in order to strengthen the security. And also zero trust means that we have to assume that all devices are not protected. So we have to constantly learn how to improve not just the password and MFA, but actually what's going on the device. So as an example, Microsoft has been pushing, innovating incredibly with Windows Defender, which is embedded in the operating system. And so when you go to try to download the file that's malicious, it will give you a warning. Said, we've seen this before. It's done really bad things. Are you sure you want to do this? Right. So I think the zero trust model is a bit like it's going in that direction where we're moving to a time when we're trying to make it easier to access your content using stronger authentications.
Excellent. So we have a number of questions in the Q&A, and being mindful of time, I'm going to go ahead and switch to some of these. Let's go ahead and answer some. Folks, there's still time if you'd like to add questions to the Q&A. It gets located at the bottom right-hand side of your display. You should see a Q&A button. Feel free to select that and type in any questions that you have. And again, if you have any additional comment that you'd like to add to it, both Peter and I can see the chat as well. So if you'd like to add any pepper, as we call it, to the conversation, feel free to. So the first question is about the recent pipeline attack that's in the press. So just curious what your thoughts are on the recent attack on the Colonial Pipeline in the Southeast United States. I've heard that the attackers used PowerShell to remove volume shadow copies of the data as part of the overall attack. Do you have any thoughts on the attack? And obviously, given that it's ongoing, we won't ask you for any technical insights or even if your team is involved. But what have you heard of the attack and what's your thoughts of that?
So I haven't heard of the attack, and this is not something I am a part of, so I really couldn't comment more. However, what I can say, Andrew, for this question, is that this is just another example of the sophistication of the criminals. As I mentioned earlier, is that criminals are working across different locales, and they have different sets of expertise. They're cybercrime as a service now. So what we're seeing here just reinforces how it's important to look at our infrastructure as companies and implement a multi-layered defense strategy in order to ensure that this type of activity does not happen. But thanks a lot for bringing it up. And you know, it just highlights how sophisticated some of these actors are and how dangerous it can be, right? When we start attacking infrastructure, it's a lot of people who can get hurt.
Sure. And I'm sure you've heard the expression, follow the lump through the snake, or follow the rat through the snake. In this case, so I'm located in Florida in the Southeast, and we're already seeing the effect of this. So we are immediate recipients of gasoline shortage as the result of this. This is what we're seeing already here with lines of cars waiting to get gasoline and gas stations without gas. Initially started from a shortage of drivers, that there weren't enough drivers to deliver the gas places. And now that issue is going to be compounded by this. So like you said, it is kind of interesting when cyber issues cascade into, meat space, as they call it, cyberspace collision, with kinetic outcomes. So,
yes. So it sounds scary. It sounds scary, doesn't it, when you put it that way? It's who would have thought? It sounds like Star Trek or Star Wars.
Yeah, absolutely. And I saw that the crew responsible for it, they went out of their way to do a tweet let the world know that they're not political and they didn't intend to attack this target in this way, and we're very sorry. And it sounded to me like a group of folks really hoping to not catch a cruise missile, because it's that type of national infrastructure, so you never know. But interesting stuff. So thank you for your question, Andrew. Our next question comes from Vic. And it is, what's the most common ways you're able to attribute cybercrime to actual individuals, obviously without exposing too much?
Oh. You know, the way I would like to think about this, Vic, is what is everything that is created by humans can be unmade by humans. So it's true that a lot of people think they can use Tor, they think they could use VPNs, RDP, SSH, you know, cPanels. They think that proxies, everyone makes a mistake, everyone. And so for cyber criminals, what is important for on the attribution side is to be thorough with the collection of evidence and at times use different resources. So for example, you may have seen last year, Microsoft DCU, we brought a civil case against the BEC, Business Email Compromise Target. Well, that civil case allowed us to identify more information about the person because they had to register a domain name, right? They had to use an email. They had to access that site from somewhere. And even though the person used VPNs and was very good on that OPSEC, RDP, remote desktop protocol, he made a mistake, right? His account checked something and we saw that. And so now we know where he is. We know exactly where he is. So I think, Vic, to answer your question, it's about being diligent, doing the right things. We don't hack into anyone. We follow the law and we try and do our best. But ultimately, attribution is possible over time. It's about persistence. And all technologies are used in collaboration with other technologies, right? They're not in silos. So I think there are, and people are creatures of habit. So you look at, for example, breach data, and you take someone's email and you look at the password associated to that email and you pivot on the password. Most people, you get kind of the other email accounts, right? Because even if you use, sometimes people use password, generic passwords, but even, anyway, there are ways to look at the data, but you just have to be very thorough in the methods of collecting it and knowing what tools you can use. Because a big part of the challenge for a lot of defenders is people don't know all the tools available. So how would you, for example, use Augury to look at NetFlow data? Well, a lot of people I know don't even know what Team Comrie is. So how would they know about Augury, right? And it's an amazing tool. Right. So it's just an example that there are different tools that can help us with attribution, but we have to do it the right way, be diligent, secure the evidence, you know, in an appropriate manner.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. So our next question comes from Rashid, an IT technician and digital inclusion consultant from Tanzania. His question is cybercrime, when it comes to the use of IoT and online transactions, what strategies are there to use to overcome and helping people use those technologies? And obviously this might be a little more technical than your area of expertise, but what's your thoughts and do you guys see IoT being targeted and things like that as part of your efforts at the DCU?
Yes, we've seen some instances where, for example, IoT devices that were not appropriately secured had been compromised and used as a botnet in an attack, right? So we see that scenario. We also see how, unpatched or vulnerable IoT devices can be used in some kind of DDoS, right? But it's kind of the same as a botnet, but you know, a little different how you use it. What we as a company, again, I don't represent the entire Microsoft. I'm from DCU, but I'm looking at the future and trying to understand how to protect our customers. And one of the things is IoT is part of 4IR, the fourth industrial revolution, right? These are the new technologies that are really going to empower all of us. But with that, and they're miniature, they're very miniature. They're like sensors sometimes. They use like LoRaWAN to broadcast large distances. Well, could that be a vector into a network, right? That sensor over there sending data in a specifically configured way that when it reaches the hub, it then does something else, right? So at Microsoft, what I do know is that there's a lot of effort that goes into creating secure IoT devices. And I think if you watch the latest sort of online summit, you'd have seen how we are even putting kind of TPM chips into the sensors in order to secure the hardware itself, right? So to Rashid, to answer your question, I think cybercrime is looking for any opportunity to make money and cause harm. And so IoT has to be, the architecture has to be developed in a secure way, understanding that there are different ways in, right? So you have to look at the hardware, you have to look at how the data is being transmitted to secure that, and look at the different endpoints and how to secure those as well. So, yeah.
Yeah. So it's interesting that you mentioned Laura and Peter. I had never seen it before until this weekend. Funny enough, one of my neighbors is, you know, for lack of a better term, a packet nerd, radio nerd. He was showing me this device infrastructure that he had built for remote sensing. And while we were playing with his system, he showed me, we were talking about how, what part of the spectrum it falls into. So we opened up a scanner of sorts to look for it. And we found four unsecured LoRaWAN gateways just within the earshot of where we were. And we're not in an industrial complex area or anything like that. And I thought, well, I mean, I've never heard of this, obviously, until today, but that's me. There are undoubtedly people who go looking specifically for these, but they were wide open gateways. Obviously, you know, Title 18 suggests we shouldn't connect to them. So we didn't and let the record reflect that. But it was very interesting. I had never heard of it. And right away, the very first experience I have with it is that there are people doing it wrong already. Of course, is like Murphy's Law.
Right, right. And just to piggyback on that, I think I mentioned hackathons. One of the hackathons I participated in is to build smart communities. And what we're trying to do is to say, is there a way of building an off-grid? A lot of people don't have access to the internet, or the data is very expensive where they are. And so is there a way of creating a localized internet that will allow people to get access to content? And using Azure IoT, we managed to build kind of a prototype system where using the IoT hub, edge end hub, we were able to build systems on the edge that would have like 1 terabyte of data that could be shared over Wi-Fi. We managed to build an app that is installed at the edge and allows people at the edge to communicate, to message between each other without even touching the internet. And to bring down a Docker container, and put it on the device at the edge and allow images of blood to be sent to it and detect, use machine learning models at the edge to detect malaria with 80% accuracy. All of that is IoT on the edge. Imagine that if we can do this now, and we're going to prototype it, trying to get some funding, but hopefully we'll get some support. Prototype it in Ghana, where we want to go to a rural community and empower them with this knowledge and information, and use the IoT as a way of getting weather forecast. So we're going to have sensors that pick up environmental data, humidity and all of that, and send it to the edge device to compute and give back predictions on, is it going to rain tomorrow? So that when you go to your farm, you're ready or whatever. They don't have that data. Right. So it's important, but how do you secure that device? Because it's doing a lot of stuff. Imagine getting false information into that machine learning model. Life and death sometimes. So,
Absolutely. Interesting. So our next question comes from Randy. And it's, what are your thoughts on the best ways to help newcomers get into cybersecurity industry, especially encouraging diverse candidates? I've been focused on providing internships and mentoring, but curious if there's other approaches to help people get a good start.
Yeah, that's a question that I think as an industry we need to think about, because there aren't really standards that exist that help, you know, create a kind of a learning path. And also cybercrime is very, cybersecurity is more complex. And when I say complex, there are different types of it. I think the best way to help people is, first of all, is to encourage the curiosity part, because that's what's ever changing, right? So if you can try and get people to think, to create their own box, not out of the box, or in the box, create their own box and say, this is how I'm going to serve people, right? Because once we go into this kind of, I've got a passion, I want to help people, I'm going to build my skills, I'm going to ask people to help. Like I've spoken about custo, go and find out what custo is. Start learning about it, because one day it could be useful, or you can start using it. I don't know. So I think, Randy, a good thing would be to like have kind of core technologies that are helpful in investigating, but also looking at providing some kind of path for people to learn what are different types of cybercrime, how are they committed, what are the tools that we need in order to protect ourselves, how do we investigate, what is IR, incident response. These are things I think that help us sort of walk in. And also, in addition to what you mentioned, I think we need to find some kind of apprenticeship model. It's hard because of the data is private, but we could start thinking about what kind of online virtual defender programs can exist so that people can learn from each other.
Okay. So we have a question in the chat from Stavros. It is, how do you do attribution when cyber criminals as a service exist? So ransomware as a service is one of the latest examples. So how do you do proper attribution is what I believe we're asking. Obviously, you could blame the criminal providing the service, but then they're only part of the problem. How do you think we could go about solving the full scope of that? Botnets are similar for what it's worth. DDoS and platforms, things like that work similarly.
So I think I'll answer this question in two parts. The first is cybercrime as a service. When we look at that, it's kind of a natural progression. As things become more sophisticated, we're just getting more people who can provide a custom service. So for example, they can offer RDP servers or SSH, or they can provide FUD links. It's a new thing. FUD links are kind of a subscription model whereby they allow links, phishing links, to remain active for a longer period of time. Anyway, there's a technique behind that. So there are different services that happen. They're just as bad, right? So I think when you look at ransomware, we kind of, again, we have a dedicated team, an amazing team, looking into combating this. But for my investigations in this space, there's really two parts to it, right? We've got the developers and we've got the affiliates, and the affiliates move around. So it's hard to get a signature of an affiliate related to, the affiliates are almost like a service, right? They jump between groups who offer the best and the most amount of return from what they get. And the developers are the ones coding in the background often. So to answer your question, I think we need to divide the two up, because then you could start building better attribution on an identity, right? A threat actor. Just looking at it as one thing doesn't work because there are many parts to it. So, you know, right now I've got some investigations into this cybercrime as a service. You know, I think I have like over 100 sites that we're tracking, and we're looking at the signatures, right? When they do something, when someone buys something from that site, or from that entity, whichever forum they may be in, you know, how do we create a signature to see what are the attributes? One thing you can't hide is being someone else. Like, I don't speak Japanese, so I'm not gonna do anything with Japanese language, or we all do things in specific ways. There's research that shows that we're predictably irrational, right? Which is kind of a cool word, I think, which means that this shirt I've had, I wear this shirt, I'm not gonna wear your shirt, right? That's predictable. Right, the same with the way you write. We can predict, we can see with machine learning models now that this, what you've written, is this person and not that person. Now, there's a way of breaking that. That's another this conversation, but I'm just saying it's predictable. So even cybercrime as a service, there is a way of creating categories based on the information. Again, we need to be thorough. We need to gather the evidence and start to understand what the evidence represents in the chain. And I think we can make it work. I hope that helps, Stavros.
Okay, so being mindful of time, Peter, one last question. So if you had some final thoughts to share with a room full of practitioners, which assume we're in a room, if you will, what would that be? What would be your closing thoughts that you'd want people to leave this session with?
My closing thoughts would be, you know, first of all, thank you for making the time to participate in this meeting, because we're all very busy in our day jobs, and especially working from home has made it even harder because we're back to back with meetings. And so being present, I'm very thankful because this is how we work together and learn from each other. As we move forward, I think as practitioners and defenders, we need to start reimagining enforcement, right? We need to start reimagining, breaking down what we grew up with and what we know in order to start afresh almost, because things have changed. Things have changed and we are in a new world. And the question is, how do we all sit down and start discussing how to better collaborate and sort of pick parts of the infrastructure and start disrupting or better protecting, creating new practices so that we're more secure. You know, you look at what Microsoft has been doing, pushing out documentation on how to secure the platform, how to protect yourselves. These are things I think we need to all work together on in order to continue to earn the trust from those that we work for, so the consumers and the different companies. So yeah, reimagine enforcement.
Excellent. Well, Peter, thank you very much for joining us today. Our thanks to both the Digital Crimes Unit, but Microsoft as a whole for sparing an hour of your time. I know you have very busy schedule and bad guys all over to catch. So thank you very much for joining us today. All of our attendees, thank you very much for taking the time out for joining us as well. We know your schedule is busy, whether you be a commercial partner of ours or a community service member, however it is that you came about hearing of the event. We thank you for taking the time out. We'd like to invite you to our next Dragon's Den chat, which will be June 9th at 11 a.m. Eastern, where our own James Shank will be meeting with Ohad Zettenberg, founder of the CTI League. So on behalf of Team Cymru, thank you very much for joining us. And that concludes our session today.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Cheers.